this is my playtime. My wife always says on a Wednesday, that's her day off when I come to the railway.
It's good occupational therapy as far as I'm concerned.
The smell of the engine and the smoke, the steam coal, the lovely smell of smoke. Always love walking about fires.
I like seeing the train coming in, you know, smelling it and hearing it and seeing the mountains behind it as it rounds the corner.
Like all these voluntary groups, it's like joining the mafia. You get in, but you can't get out. You know, you tend to get sucked in.
Our dream is to create something that people can look at and say, my God, that brings me back. And we want to retain something good from the past that otherwise would be junked.
There was a time when taking the train was a pleasure, and not just a means of getting from A to B as fast as possible. Nowadays, that golden age of steam may not seem so environmentally friendly with its coal-hungry fires and billowing stacks, but actually, those clouds of smoke were mostly water. If you're of a certain age, you maybe still have romantic recollections of the rattle and rhythm of the rails. But even those who are too young to remember it seem enthralled by these ghosts from a bygone age. For over 20 years, volunteers of the Downpatrick and County Down Railway Society have dedicated themselves to turning a wasteland into vibrant living history. Now, I know what you're thinking, but it's not just a lot of old men fired up with nostalgia, indulging their past. They work hard, restoring rolling stock and rusty lines on a small part of what was once the essential transport service in County Down until its death in 1950. And they try to make a bit of money to keep the whole thing going all year round. They get into the spirit of Halloween. Just before Christmas, they call upon one of their many friends.
Another one up here. Oh, good.
They play their part in local community festivals like St. Patrick's Day. And the whole of Easter weekend is devoted to giving people the chance to step back in time, if only for a short while.
This is one of our big days. We do try to do the thing correctly. And one of the things that you expect when you go to somewhere is that people are dressed up in some kind of uniform which distinguishes them from the rest of the public.
That's the first thing that people see when they meet the staff. If they were just dressed in their ordinary working clothes, it wouldn't be the thing at all, you know.
Makes you feel the part. Yeah, it makes you feel the part. If, say, your wife is also interested and gets involved, it makes it a heck of a lot easier for, like, me to go down and, you know, do my hobby.
This whistle is an Acme Thunderer. Belonged to my grandfather, who was a tramway man before the First World War. Those who remember seeing Titanic, Kate Winslet at the end taking the whistle from the dead officer's mouth in the sea and blowing it, this is what she was using, an Acme Thunderer. This would wake the dead. The railways were always labour intensive, and preserved railways are labour intensive as the real thing. For example, on a public operating day, you have to have people selling tickets, people in the shop, people on the platform to stop members of the public from falling under trains. You have to have driver, fireman, guard, conductor on the train to talk to the public. You have to have people on each platform. So you can't really run a public operating day with fewer than about 20 people, and that's cutting it a bit fine.
Yeah. I'm the fireman today, and Norman there is the driver. Well, the fireman has to make sure there's the fire's boiling the water, basically, to make the steam.
Today I like to think that my job is to keep the customers happy, really. This is a real opportunity to ask them, have they enjoyed themselves, and what did they think of what they've seen. And a lot of people are very interested about the history of the railway.
My job there today is the train guard. The guard is in charge of the safe operation of the train service. He makes sure that the doors are all closed, the signals are all off, before he tells the driver to depart.
The sort of museum we run tries to show the exhibits being used as they were intended to be used, and to give the general public a feel, I feel like a better feel, for what it was like. Enthusiasts will come because they're interested in railways, or they're interested in some aspect of railways. Then there's the members of the general public. They come maybe just for the day out, somewhere to go for the day. It doesn't really matter, they're just interested in the day out with the kids. Really, I suppose there's two things we want out of it. We want to enjoy creating it, because we're not getting paid for this. It's purely a hobby. But we also want other people to get enjoyment out of experiencing it. Just ordinary families who come in here, spend a few hours with us and go away and feel, that was really good, that was different, or I learned something I didn't know before. That's really what it's about.
For people nowadays, Edwardian travel is a novelty. They've never seen it before. A lot of children haven't even been on a train.
Hi, trees.
A lot of the older people would remember the carriages, they remember the compartments with the photographs up on the walls and the mirrors and things like that. And the leather straps for opening the windows and that sort of thing. That all brings back their childhood and their youth, you know. A lot of people have actually travelled on this railway in the past, before it closed in 1950.
In total, the Society has restored about 3 miles of track, forming a triangle between Downpatrick, the old loop platform, and the stop they created near Inch Abbey. This is only a small part of the original rail network which served County Down for over a century.
The old Belfast and County Down Railway was quite a compact little railway. It was essentially a suburban railway. It only operated within County Down, but it was a very busy railway.
There was over 80 miles of track in the network. It started in Belfast at Queen's Quay Station, now demolished, near to the Queen's Bridge and where the Odyssey Arena and M3 flyover is now. A branch line to Bangor, which still exists today, split at Ballymacarrot, but the main line hugged the Newton Arts Road, passing over it at the Hollywood Arches and through Bloomfield, Neil's Hill, Knock and Dundonald stations before travelling on to Cumber. At Cumber, the line split again with a branch to Newton Ards and Donaghadee, where the station was actually a terraced house. From Cumber, however, the main line went through Ballygowan, Sainfield and Ballinahinch Junction, where another branch went to Ballinahinch Town. The main line rolled through the Drumlin country to Crossgar and then the terminus at Downpatrick, where it split again with a branch through Ballynoe to the fishing village of Ardglass. The final section of the main line, however, ran from Downpatrick through a station at Tullymurray near Clough and on to Dundrum and finally Newcastle, where another branch line joined the Great Northern Railway at Castlewellan.
Well, some of the stations are still in existence. Their station, for example, at Saintfield is still substantially intact. Tullymurray is still intact. Large part of Newcastle station is still there. Ardglass is still recognisable.
and the sales. That's right.
And as well as some of the stations, some of the railway men who worked on the line are still around too, but their numbers are dwindling. James McGill and Willie Watterson were based at Tullymurray.
November 1939, I got off the train here from Newcastle. You think, like, here there'd be nothing to do, but you see, with the war on started, there's a lot of traffic. My job was just a clerical work, writing, issuing tickets. A lot of military tickets, they're all had to be written by hand. And telegraph instrument, learning a telegraph instrument, that I had to learn that. And general office duties.
I started on the 4th of January 1938. And as a boy porter, there were 7 lamps from one end of the platform to the other. And you had to take those lamps into the lamp room. And you took them in and you cleaned them. Another thing was you had to do some work for the station master. You'd have to cut sticks for the fire and get the coal in into the office. And parcels, as the train came in, you took the parcels out of the garage van.
Adam Hamilton from Belfast actually worked on several of the County Down locomotives, including this one, the only one which has been preserved at Cultra.
I got started as a cleaner, 1941, and I'd done different jobs, sent me the smoke box, and cleaned the fires, bunkered the coal up, and then it's come my time to go to be passed as a fireman. So of course you went across to the office of Mr. Crosswaite, and you took your cap off under your arm, your morning shirt, and you stood the attention, and then Mr. Crosswaite say, "Hamilton, what's the first thing a fireman looks for when he goes on the footplate?" I said, "The first thing he looks for, sir, is the water in the boiler." Asked about different things about the lubricators and the injectors and all, told him about that. So after that, anyway, well, he says, "You're passed for the fireman. Start duty in the morning."
Tommy McMullen was a signalman at Crossgar Station. It has been demolished, but the signal cabin was similar to the one still standing at the former Saintfield Station.
Well, this was the job that I did, nothing else but this. Operating the points, looking after the, of course we had to look after the signals. 2 sets on the Down Patrick side, 2 sets of signals on the Crossgar side. And if they weren't operating, the trains weren't operating, you know, that type of thing. In the morning, about 4:30 or 5 o'clock, the goods trains coming in from Belfast, the person who did it before me was Ringland Quinn. And if Ringland had a supper drink the night before, and he didn't get in time, and all you'd have heard about 5 o'clock in the morning was the hoots of the engine to get somebody to just open the point. Oh, the uniform was a terrific thing. and my bandy legs. There's one of the photos of me coming down the stairs there, and the legs are nice and bandy, and anyone who has seen it so far have laughed at it.
It's fair to a man, a driver called Mickey O'Neill, and we've done it back to Newcastle. And he says, "Adam, what about a fry?" I said, "That'll be lovely." So down I went to Newcastle, I got the soda bread, the tinny bread, the bacon and the eggs, and a bit of lard. And up I came with my bag of stuff, onto the footplate, got my shovel and a bit of waste, give her a bit of a rub, she was always shining. Opened the door, wrist door right open, put the shovel on, put my bit of lard on, and I done a lovely fry. In 1942, the Americans came, and we had these military specialists and distributed them down different parts of the country, you know.
Because of the secrecy, they got very short notice to put on it, provide trains. As a result, they had to search around for staff to man them. So they recruited them, the pubs. This particular night, I had on duty at Ballykinder Halt with a train load of soldiers coming in, and part of my job was to get the ticket off the guard, because the ticket was what they really was paid on. Nowhere could I see the guard. I went right up, went to the engine driver, say, where's the guard? He knew rightly where he was. He's back there somewhere, he says. So I walked back to the guard's van, looked through the window. The guard was lying prostrate on the ground, flat out drunk. So I left him there.
In 1948, the railways in Northern Ireland, which were owned by private companies, began to be nationalised under the Ulster Transport Authority, which also had responsibility for bus routes. They felt there wasn't room for both, and the railways lost out.
By the 1950s, the government had decided it'd be cheaper to move everything onto the roads than to invest in railways that had been run down during the Second World War. It needed a lot of investment to bring them back up to scratch again. So they simply said, what's the point of spending all this money on the railways? All we need to do is close the railways and people will use the buses and people will use the lorries. And that's what they did.
Last day was on a Sunday night. There's 12 coaches, two engines, and two guards. And so it was packed. Back to the doors. So I lit all the lamps. I put the old detonators down on the line and they gave her a send off. And there's people here to see her going.
I think every station did the same thing when the train came in, the bang, 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 off they went.
It was a cold winter night, the 15th of January 1950.
Sad time for the, for what I call the really railway men, people who had maybe been 30, 40, maybe up to 50 years in the blooming place, and were just taken away from them.
Terribly, terribly sad. I felt terrible about it. I still felt that it couldn't happen. Say they'll come back, they'll run again. I couldn't just accept that there wouldn't be any more railways after working on them so long.
Ah, near broke my heart, that's right, it did. Because the railways are in my blood, you know. And from a boy, that was your ambition, you know. I still hear the sound of the train still running, you know, in a clear night, puffing away there, you know.
The Belfast and County Down Railway was one of the first of the lines to be ripped up over the next decade. The rails were sold for scrap. And you probably know someone who's used one of the old sleepers to make a feature for their house or garden. For years after the closures, some railway groups tried to get lines for steam trains, including the DCDR, rebuilt in several places in Northern Ireland, but their plans fell through. One man, though, would not let it go.
The project really started with a walk that Jerry Cochrane took one nice day out through Downpatrick Marshes along the line of the old railway that came into the town.
I was really impressed because it was such a beautiful area. Totally unspoilt, and exactly as it would have appeared 100 years ago.
And he thought how good it would be to reinstate part of the old County Down line in that area as a tourist attraction. And when he gets an idea into his head, there's nothing will shift it.
The main interest was to try and save a lot of the historic carriages and wagons and things that were still about, but they were very fast disappearing. Within a couple of years, I knew it would be gone forever.
By 1982, he had secured vital support from the local council, and with a few dedicated helpers, his dream began to take shape.
This area here behind me, or over here where the cars are parked, that was the site of the original railway terminus. If you look at where the shops are over there, that was the site of the station, the original station. And it was quite a big place because it was originally the terminus of the line in Belfast. And the passenger station was on the main street.
Where we are standing here now, where the station is built and where these tracks are, were the original approaches to the railway station. And it was Lord Dunleith who made this possible by granting us the land we needed to get this project going.
It was a struggle initially to get people to come on a regular basis. But then when they started to come, it then snowballed. People came out of the woodwork, just seemed to turn up.
They had barely started when the old BCDR's jewel in the crown was almost literally unearthed.
There was someone that said, I have an old railway carriage in my land and I want rid of it. Jerry and one or two others went out to have a look at it, and their eyes nearly popped out of their head when they saw what it was. It was the coach built for the royal visit of 1897 of the Duke and Duchess of York. When we found it, it still had some of its original fixtures and fittings, gas chandeliers, Welsh photographs on the walls, some of the Regency striped material, and from about a foot and a half to 2 foot down, chicken shit.
And amazingly, the farmer who sold it charged them the princely sum of £35, the price he felt it was worth in firewood.
At that stage, we had nowhere to put it, but we got great help from the RAF at Bishop's Court, and they allowed us to store it on the runway.
It was such a staggering find, the story even made the local news bulletins.
It doesn't look like transport fit for royalty, and it doesn't look like a hen house either. But this truly unique train carriage has been both. It was built for the Belfast and County Down Railway 100 years ago for the exclusive use of royal visitors, including King Edward VII in 1903. In its glory days, this carriage was the ultimate in luxury, with yellow silk drapes on the windows, satinwood panelling on the walls, and Axminster on the floor.
There is so much restoration to be done to bring the royal coach back to its former glory that work is still going on. It was a superb start, and the society could hardly believe how much more of the rolling stock had survived.
We found that it was mostly by people coming along and saying, I have an old railway carriage on my farm, or I have an old, there's no railway carriage in my field, would you be interested?
With very little money, they had to beg and borrow from companies and friends to collect the stock. Now so much has turned up, it will take years to restore all of it.
They look rough. They are rough. But so would you be if you'd been treated the way they've been treated over the last 20, 30, 40 years. But they are actually very historic vehicles, and when we get through with them, there'll be people coming here to see them. A large proportion of the original volunteers, people who were involved back in the 1985-86 when I started, are still there. But over the years we have gathered new people in.
I'm actually having to clean the paint off this locomotive right down to the bare metal. One of the previous owners did a very rough job on it, and it's actually showing up. It's impossible to get a good surface again, so I'm going to have to go right back to the start. It's going to be a long job, but we'll get there.
Whenever this was sold to a farmer, he cut it in half. And when, obviously when we got it, it was cut in half, so we're joining it together now. Put a steel plate on the top and a steel plate underneath, and I'm bolting right through. 2 years should complete this.
And what I'm at the moment is to remove all the old paint from the interior of the coach at this point in time. The outside we'll deal with later on. So once we get all the old paint off, which is quite a bit of a task, then the actual repainting, it'll be relatively straightforward. So hopefully that'll go a little bit quicker and a little bit easier than what I'm at the moment.
I was born at Inverary Drive, just overlooking the railway line at Sydenham. In 1933, when I left the local school, My mother decided to send me to the model school in the Cliftonville Road, which was quite a distance, you know, in the opposite direction. And she was worried about a wee fellow of 8 years of age travelling through the traffic in Belfast. And fortunately, she knew, she had a friend in Hollywood called Miss McLeave, and she worked as a typist in the Belfast Telegraph. And the arrangement was that I would meet her on the train at Sydenham, and then she would take me across town. So I had no trouble. I always met her in the same seat. She always sat in the third seat, at the seat at the third window. It was shunted into the shed here, and as soon as I got into it, I was filled with nostalgia about this coach, and I looked round and I thought, gracious me, this is the coach I used to travel in. It crowded all those school memories back into my head.
We are trying, as far as possible, to recreate the way it was done originally, no matter what it is, whether it's issuing a ticket or lighting a light.
They are the original gas lamps. The bezel is the original, the reflectors are the same. The light is actually electric. It's powered by a halogen bulb. And the halogen bulb is covered by an original gas mantle. So it gives the same effect.
Everything that you see in this carriage is authentic. Now, the very, very first train ever to come into Downpatrick was on the 23rd of March, 1859. They then set about, of course, extending the railway. They reached Newcastle, 1869, and they reached Ardglass, 1872.
I helped to lay the track from Downpatrick here to Inchabbey. You know, my wife used to give off to me all the time because she used to say, you know, you'll take a heart attack out there someday. Because as I tell the people on the train, the heaviest thing ever I lifted in my life was to put a woman's leg to put a shoe on it.
This is my playtime. My wife always says on a Wednesday, that's her day off when I come to the railway.
We do have some railway widows. I think they're probably very glad to get shot of the husbands, that men that have been out working all their lives and they don't want them under their feet, so they're quite happy to see them.
But it would be wrong to think the society is dominated by old men who just want to get out of the house.
We have a husband and wife set up. His wife comes with him and helps out, and so does his daughter. We have another gentleman. His daughter will help on the buffet car.
We never got to the darn causeway.
Oh, my goodness. My grandfather drove trains. He was a train driver on this very line. And I think because of his passion, my dad has a passion for trains. And whenever we used to go on family holidays, we would go to whatever nearest steam railway we were at. And that's always been associated with very happy times. So then when my dad got involved down here, it was the natural thing to do. And he dragged my son in as well, and he's 13 and he gets very dirty and he really enjoys himself.
We have a father and son, Herbie and Norman Woodell. Herbie is was a BT engineer, and his son Norman, he looks after our locomotives.
When Norman was a young boy, we used to come down here to see the trains. Eventually started coming down to do a little bit of work. One day a month turned into one day a week, and then as often as possible, providing Norman's mother doesn't object.
You get trained out for various jobs. You get trained out first for guard, and then diesel driver, fireman, steam driver. It's basically you're taught by the people that are driving at the minute or two, and you slowly work up through the ranks.
I realise I'm one of only a few women who are involved down here. honestly say that that is never something I've really consciously thought about, because I see us as very much a team. We're a group of people who are very diverse in lots of ways. We come from all over the place, from different backgrounds. We're all sorts of ages, but we share a passion for the railway, and that makes us a team, and that is why it's such good fun being here.
People would ask us why we do it. Personally, I have not got a notion. We just do it. We do seem to get labelled as anoraks, but I don't care.
Now, what is the maximum curve? There has to be a maximum, surely.
At a maximum, of course, you're right. It's a straight, isn't it?
Stop asking questions, because they're definitely not going to give nothing away.
Right the way down to the gate down there, please, Billy.
Railway preservation does have sometimes an unfortunate image. I mean, the word anorak was probably coined because of the train spotters that used to haunt the end, the slopy ends of platforms, taking numbers, wearing their anoraks and carrying their flasks.
There's three bubbles in this. Which one do we use?
People who will spend all day on the golf course, or people who will sit all day by the river with a rod, will look down their nose on people who work on restoring old railways as anoraks. It's no different. It's just different people have different interests.
There is a tendency for people to say, those guys are playing with trains, you know, but if they were able to see the blood, sweat and toil that goes into this, they would realise that we're not playing. It's serious business.
But there's no point having beautifully restored carriages and locomotives with nothing to run on, so they've also had to lay miles of track.
A lot of it was learned through trial and error. I have a photograph of them standing, scratching their heads and looking at it. How do they get this bit of track to fit these sleepers? And we eventually worked out faster, safer, quicker ways of laying the track. And we're now quite good at it, quite slick at it.
I've been working on the railroad all the livelong day. I've been working on the railroad just to pass the time away. Don't you hear the whistle blowing? Rise up so early in the morn. Can't you hear the captain shouting?
The line had to run through marshes and across water, and many of the bridges had disappeared. Luckily, one of them was still in existence, because if that had not been there, they would never have made it to the old loop platform. It had deteriorated so badly, the canopy had to be completely torn down and replaced with a copy. Reaching that in 1987 was a major milestone, so it was time for a celebration.
We got a folding table and put it in the flat wagon, and we got wind cheese. One of our members got a toilet roll, and it was held across the track, and the diesel went through it, and for the first time in 50 years a train stopped it at the loop platform. The first public train, however, consisted of just a locomotive and a brake van.
At Downpatrick, there was only a makeshift wooden platform, so a completely new station had to be built. As the original had been demolished years before, the ever-resourceful Jerry arranged to have the old gasworks manager's house completely dismantled, moved piece by piece from the other side of Market Street, and reassembled on its new site. With this in place, they were ready for the official grand opening in 1990 by their benefactor, Lord Dunleith. But in 2002, disaster struck. A malicious fire by vandals almost completely destroyed Downpatrick Station and its priceless artefacts. Undaunted, the Society not only rebuilt that, but also built their very own bridge on the River Coyle and a new line to a new platform near Inch Abbey. They seem to have endless energy, and the visitor days have become a must for many families during holiday periods.
The reason we run the railway is primarily because it's our creation. We've put all that work into it, and we enjoy people enjoying it. There's no point in putting about that amount of effort into a project and then keeping it hidden. The other reason, and the practical reason, is that the money that we earn is an important part of keeping the whole thing going. As far as the future is concerned, it can't be that much bigger than what we have at the moment.
At one stage, we looked at the possibility of extending it to Dundrum, but that would require a major commitment by the council and the tourist board and that sort of thing. I don't think I'll see it in my lifetime, you know.
Even if someone came along with open checkbook and said, look, you can build a line wherever you like, we'll fund it. It would be difficult to see how we could do that and still run the thing. And when people come out for the day, they don't want to go for miles. They want to come in at 2 o'clock, go for a run, have a cup of tea, go for a walk, and be back in their car at 5 o'clock to go home for their tea. And if you say, well, we can take you 15 miles, they don't want that. And they're not prepared to pay the money either that it would require in terms of fares.
I have a down on Wednesday.
Right, George.
And Patricia will be here.
In the future, we would like to keep going in this direction for about another half mile, and that would take us to the hamlet of Ballydugan, where there's an absolutely beautiful little setting with a restored 18th century corn mill, lovely lake, and a little hostelry. That would be a natural destination, and the railway would stop, and that would be our destination for, we would hope, the immediate term.
And, it would be great to be able to get as far as the middle at Ballydugan.
It was a dream which became a nightmare at times. It's very comforting to see it now developed and to see that it still has potential to develop even further.
Yeah.
Yeah.
1986, I thought they were all nuts. I just went along for the ride to see how long it would last. I thought, if we get the loop platform, that'd be pretty good fun. I didn't think 20 years later that would be as big as it is.
It would certainly ease the traffic problems, wouldn't it, if people could travel out.